Okay, afternoon. And this paper is called Phonography, Mediation and the Challenge of Audiophile Aesthetics. So, most of us experience music in mediatized form every day. We hear recorded music by speakers in shops, public places, via our mobile phones or iPods, computers, televisions and so on. The primary experience most of us have of music on a day-to-day basis is in recorded form. And of course, the status of the recording itself has been the subject of large amounts of literature, an example demonstrated by volumes such as the Cambridge Companion's Recorded Music, Amanda Bailey's Recorded Music Performance, Culture and Technology, amongst many others that I could have listed here as well. All of this kind of work might fall under the label of what Stephen Cottrell has called phonomusicology, the study of recorded music and the context in which it is produced and consumed. And of course, phonomusicology riffs on phonography, a term perhaps brought most into discourse by Evan Eisenberg's classic text, The Recording Angel. Phonography assumes that listening to music via recordings is the result of a complex series of technological exchanges and mediations. After all, music is, Georgina Bourne says, perhaps the paradigmatic, multiply mediated, immaterial and material, fluid, quasi-object in which subjects and objects collide and intermingle. It favours associations or assemblages between musicians and instruments, composers and scores, listeners and sound systems, that is, between subjects and objects. We can see this formulation borne out in some of the literature and record production, for example. Heavily influenced by approaches such as Bruno Latour's actor network theory, it talks of the ways in which human actors engage with each other and technology in order to produce recordings. Given the extensive literature on recorded music, there is remarkably little on the technologies that we use for playback. There is, for example, literature by Michael Pull, such as his book Sound Moves, which examines how consumers use devices like the iPod to soundtrack their everyday lives. Similarly, there is Tia Dinora's book, Music in Everyday Life, although it takes a slightly broader stance, less concerned with the specific technologies in play than Bull is. And of course, work on the development of these listening technologies has a very broad literature, including Jonathan Stern's seminal book, The Audible Past, A Cultural History of Sound Reproduction. But what interests me here is the fact that these devices that we use to play music are so little talked about when we talk about recordings. And I suggest that the absence of these technologies isn't accidental, but it actually represents a kind of philosophy of mediation, a transparent, vanishing mediation, reproduction that's faithful to the original. Or put differently, very rarely in discourses on music that is disseminated primarily in recorded form do we take notice of these technologies. To write about recorded music as being effortlessly reproduced is to subscribe to this philosophy, which is a kind of version of the idea of fidelity. But fidelity is itself a historically contingent idea, as Jonathan Stern argues in The Audible Past, not a kind of gold standard to which technological progress marches inevitably. In this paper, I will try to argue that these technologies of playback are significant, that their absence from discourse is problematic, and that properly considered, they pose some interesting challenges to how we think about phonography. To explore these themes, I'm going to engage with ideas from audiophile culture. Now, this might seem a little strange. Audiophile culture is often characterized, at least in this country, as eccentric, bearing out an unhealthy obsession with technology, collecting, geek culture, the province of middle-aged men with too much disposable income, and so on. But I think audiophiles think more about recordings and the act of listening and the technologies that we use to listen than perhaps most scholars do. So audiophile culture provides a kind of laboratory in which to think through some of these issues. Central to the idea of recorded music and how we engage with it is reproduction. The idea that no matter where we listen and how, somehow the recorded object is always there for us to experience. This has led to the idea that to listen to a piece of recorded music is to repeat it, repetition being the great facility that sound technology offers. Earlier in the 20th century, this idea of repetition prompted wide-ranging anxieties about how it might somehow diminish the effect of music, even if those anxieties are much less in evidence today. But these ideas of reproduction and repetition are deeply problematic. They posit the idea of some authentic original event that can be repeated, making music into an object for consumption. They imagine that it is possible to experience the mediatized object as being the same as the original. The fact is that most literature that deals with music and recorded form buys into this premise of reproduction and repetition. The effect is, sometimes at least, to create a kind of autonomous musical object that floats free of technological mediation at the point of playback. But seeing music as multiply mediated does not imply that at all, quite the opposite. So it is that Georgina Bourne suggests that we shift the terms of the discussion from listening to the broader category of musical experience, in this way allowing for questions of the corporeal, the affective, the collective, and located nature of musical experience, aka listening, to arise in a stronger way than heretofore. In other words, we locate listening as something that takes place within a context. And here, of course, I want to look particularly at the technologies that act within that context. Consider what Thomas Porcello calls tecoustomology. Tecoustomology, he says, foregrounds the implication of forms of technological mediation on individuals' knowledge and interpretations of sensations in and consequent actions upon their acoustic environments as grounded in the specific times and places of the production and reception of sound. He also suggests in a different publication, like the phenomenologist, I suspected that the ultimate significance of music resides not solely in musical texts per se, but rather in social and individual processes of musical encounter. Yet the phenomenology of music has remained largely text-centric. To balance this tendency to privilege the text, one must stress the importance of the temporal aspects of experiencing music. So I want to try and think about recorded music in this way as an encounter, one mediated through a whole series of different factors, one of which is these listening technologies through which we experience music. With that in mind, I want to try and introduce you to an audiophile event at which listening to music is all pervasive. This is the Audiophile Show, typically held at a large hotel somewhere in the UK. These events are usually run by industry and allow manufacturers and dealers to showcase their wares. In these shows, individual rooms within the hotels are converted into listening spaces, each housing a different playback system. Naturally, these range in shape, size, and colour, but unsurprisingly, most things are grey or black, with a little bit of wood in there as well. These pictures are all within the public domain, but they give you a bit of an idea of what these shows look like. These are not simply product demonstrations where you go to watch and listen to something working. The point is to listen to what each system sounds like in the room in which it's located, playing a specific recording. So participants will walk from room to room, often spending quite a long time in each room, maybe less time, and they will sit and listen to music. What is the focal point here are the technologies of playback. They exert, as you can see here with these particularly large loudspeakers, they exert a very imposing presence very often as well. The music that's being played in these events is often not so clearly presented. If you don't recognise a piece of music, often the only way to find out what it is to go and ask. As someone interested in this culture, I find it interesting to attend events like this and then try and compare my experiences with those of other participants, which they write about in online forums. And what's clear is that for audiophiles, it's not a question of what sounds best, but it is the interaction between a recording, the technology, and the environment. Participants will talk about hearing a certain recording in a certain room on a certain system as an example of something either good or bad. These encounters are actually, for audiophiles, almost like the ritual of attending a performance with the knowledge that it might be good or bad, but also with the potential for it to have an element of the extraordinary. And what provides that critical mediation is not, in this case, the human agency of performance, but the agency exerted by these technologies interacting with a particular acoustic space and a recording. In some senses, then, this ritual audiophiles go through is perhaps a lot closer to performance than we might expect. If these encounters with recorded music then represent a confluence of different factors, what can we say about the music that audiophiles play? Audiophiles are well known for having fairly limited tastes in some respects. Now, while this is something of an unfair stereotype, the music generally used by hi-fi dealers and those in the industry tends to be pretty stylistically limited. The generalization tends to be jazz, acoustic music, progressive rock, and particularly artists like Diane Krall, Nora Jones, and Nils Lofgren. This following slide is a sign from a Doored and Audiophile show that's been widely circulated on Audiophile websites. I'm not sure exactly where it's from. you get the general idea. Now, the recordings that audiophiles tend to favor, or at least the industry favors, tend to favor certain kinds of production styles, especially those that project a clear sense of acoustic image in which individual instruments can be clearly placed. And this is one of the qualities that audiophiles often ascribe particularly to loudspeakers and amplifiers. Sound staging, the ability to project a clear sense of imaging into a room. And as Aidan Stevens suggests, this kind of aesthetic directly privileges certain kinds of recorded music over others. The sonic characteristics of particular recordings also come to be a kind of means by which to evaluate sound reproduction, as the example I will discuss now shows. This example also represents an interesting instance of contemporary pop that has started to make an appearance on playlists at audiophile shows. Three-piece London Grammar were formed in 2009 and have released two albums, If You Wait, in 2013, and Truth Is a Beautiful Thing in 2017. Instrumentally, their music is relatively sparse by modern pop standards. Most songs use an underpinning guitar or keyboard part, simple percussion programming or drum loops, sometimes with an added string section. Their music has sometimes been compared to the XX, a band using a similarly pared-down textural palette. One of the most distinctive features of their sound is the voice of vocalist Hannah Reid. Reid's vocal range is somewhat atypical for a pop vocalist, situated more in the typical range of a contralto than a soprano, and many of the band's songs make deliberate use of the lower part of her range down around middle C. On the other hand, when she gets an octave up, the upper part of her range sounds very rich, impassioned, and resonant. The production of their records clearly foregrounds the voice. It's not swamped of backing vocals or many effects other than reverb, but sits right at the front of the texture. And their music also makes a certain use of extended bass registers. Take the song Hey Now, which I'm just going to play a quick clip of, which will become relevant again in a minute.
Hey now, let us burning by my bed for you. Hey now, I can feel my instincts here for you.
Now consider this for a moment. This is a little clip from a podcast called Beginner Audiophile, hosted by Michael O'Neill. And here you'll hear him discussing pairs of headphones with a particular mention of that song you just heard.
Great. I really liked them. And I was using a particular track that I kept, you know, repeating. It was like the little 10-second piece that I wanted to hear from every different headphone manufacturer, which was from a song called Hey Now by London Grammar. And it's right at 1:15, if you guys pick up that track. There's a thing where it's beautiful, ethereal voice. You get a nice sense of how it does vocals. And then the rest of the song kicks in, and if it's right, it'll kind of, the mid bass will nail you a little bit. At least that's how I like it to feel. So,
okay, so I'm going to try and play the bit in question so you can hear it. Almost as if to demonstrate my point, I have no idea how this is going to come across in these speakers. Oh. So I've put a bit of a frequency analysis just so you can see what happens at this point. Podcast was O'Neill talking about this as a test track, which he uses to listen to the qualities of different headphones to hear how they handle a particular moment in a particular song. And as you can hear, he's concerned particularly with how they perform with the bass frequencies. And then at that particular moment in the track, a very kind of low, almost kick drum-like sound comes in. I reckon it's around 40 hertz, although I'm no engineer, and you can kind of see it on that plot. And clearly the experience you have with this track and at that moment will be quite different depending on the technology that you use to play it. So when I was preparing this paper and I was playing that through my laptop speaker, that moment didn't really sound like much at all. And then I went to a big mixing room in my university and played the same thing back, and the effect is entirely different, as you can imagine. O'Neill uses this track as a test track because of its ability to show up differences in how headphones realize it. The recording might be being repeated, but its effect isn't. And O'Neill also has a sense of what he considers to be the right presentation. So perhaps this might be a crude example, but the point is this. Tracks like this work for audiophile shows because the manner in which they are produced allows playback systems to demonstrate certain valued characteristics. In this case, the reproduction of vocals and the production of clear but not overpowering bass frequencies. Recorded music for the audiophile is always acted on by technology, and the results of that action reflect both on the recording and the technology that plays it back. The technology only has meaning when it is playing music, when its attributes are being heard. To try and conclude then, I think that too often our conceptions of phonography have privileged the music as the thing being mediated. The idea of musical encounter and techoustomology suggests something different. Rather than us encountering music through the mediation of technology, recordings and the technologies that play them mediate each other in complex ways, further mediated by location, time, circumstances, social surroundings, and so on. To follow Porcello's line of thought and think about encounter and techoustomology is to acknowledge the radical possibility that in encounters in which recorded music is involved, we might experience the technology more than the music. So what of phonography? I suggest that to study recorded music must not be to instate a kind of autonomy where the musical object floats free of its reproduction. Recorded music only becomes sound when it leaves its containment in a medium, when it is played back through technology. Phonography has to include the whole chain of mediations, not necessarily privileging the music, but including these technologies. The challenge of audiophile aesthetics is to abandon ideas we might have that recordings sound the same every time, to acknowledge their role in events and experiences, that they are transformed through playback in ways that bring the agency of those technologies to the fore. Thank you very much.
Have any of these audiophile gatherings or conferences, did you call them, do they ever happen in recording studios or university premises?
I've been to one set of university premises. Generally, no. Some manufacturers like to claim that they have a very close association with the industry in the sense that they produce products both for the studio and the home user, and that's quite a big marketing thing for them. But the two markets seem, at least from my experience, to be kept quite separate.
I think the interesting for audiophiles to actually go into a studio, like the main one you've got at Hull, and actually hear some of those tracks that they're testing, and how's it sounding?
There is also that big trend among audiophiles. Some audiophiles deliberately like to use studio monitors at home. Others prefer to use more coloured kinds of speakers. So there is an interesting thing going on there as well.
One of the things that I love is that moment of that podcast where the guy's teaching you how to hear, what to hear.
Yeah.
And clearly there's a deep, like the learning curve on this, and how to hear, what to hear. Here's the question. How does one begin? Like, what kind of ritual process is involved in becoming a new audiophile? Like, clearly you're not born with it, so how does one typically?
All right, well, there are really good studies of this, anthropological studies of this, so I'm drawing on things, not so much my own experience, but the standard thing seems to be that you have to be initiated, so you have to have a friend or a relative who's into it who can teach you about it.
I'm certain.
Generally, I think in from my own experience of sort of inhabiting, trying to inhabit this world, a lot of it in the UK seems to be about learning to be very clever about how you spend your money. There's a term that's used on some UK audiophile websites, which is an acronym, it's something like SPSV or something, but it basically means the amount of improvement in the audio that you get per extra pound that you spend.
Right.
So the main thing seems to be learning how to get that improvement by spending as little as possible without spending a huge amount of money on something that only makes a tiny difference. But in the UK at least, one of the main things that seems to draw people in are these online forums, which are very big things in the UK. A lot of people get into it through those things, I think.
Thanks for the talk. I was curious about in your accounts of specific individual audiophiles, how they deal with balancing their sort of fetishization, fascination with technology with listening moments. And I'm thinking partly here because there's an article by Nokalainen and Pyre that came out in Technovation 3 years ago that they did a large-scale data analysis of every single post on Vinyl Engine for 2 years. And so they did a sort of quantitative automated analysis of like, you know, incidence of terms and like, you know, which terms are coming together and sort of conclusion. I mean, it's a bit of a wacky study, but the conclusion wasn't that surprising. That a lot of people were, the goal of the forum was to talk about the technology way more than the music itself. So I was just wondering if you encountered people and how they grapple with that.
Yeah.
Or the upgrade itis or all the other stuff.
One of the things I've certainly looked at, which is good, is Robert Harley, who's the editor of the Absolute Sound in the US, one of the big websites and magazines. He has this book called The Complete Guide to High-End Audio, and he basically says, if you become more concerned with the technology and the music, then you've fallen into a trap. You've gone the wrong way. You've got this kind of thing going on where you have to kind of be into the technology, but if you're not enjoying the music, then it's not working. So some people talk about like system fatigue, for example, whereby if you get bored of it, or if you have to stand up and keep turning knobs, that means something's wrong. But you can only judge how good it is if you can sit and listen to it for an hour without getting up. So there's a kind of a funny interplay between the two things about being into the technology, but also being able to enjoy the experience. And if you can't enjoy the experience, then you're not really an audiophile. So it sort of works both ways in an interesting kind of thing I haven't quite worked out yet.
The University of Huddersfield, inspiring tomorrow's professionals.